Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we're going to be talking about how Koenigsegg stole the spotlight from Bugatti. So Bugatti was all excited because their new Chiron hit 0 to 400 kilometers per hour back down to zero in 41.96 seconds, just under 42 seconds. So they were super stoked about 42 seconds, and then Koenigsegg said, hey, you know, we could do that a lot faster. And they did. So they did 0 to 400 to zero in 36.44 seconds. So in this video, we're going to analyze those times and talk about how Koenigsegg basically destroyed the Chiron in this test. So starting off with some specs about the vehicle, the Chiron weighs about 2,000 kilograms, about 4,400 pounds, and has 1,500 horsepower. The Agera RS was a little bit modified, so it does have an upgraded engine. This isn't the base engine that the Agera RS has. It has their 1 megawatt engine in it, so 1,360 horsepower. The car only weighs 1,395 kilograms, so 600 kilograms less, but it does have a cage in it, so that would add a little bit of weight, and the cage that they added is removable. So they have this like customer option that you can have a cage that's pretty simple to take in and out. So the first thing we're going to do is analyze the time it took for each of these vehicles to get to 100 kilometers per hour, 200, 300, and 400 kilometers per hour. I've got the braking times there already. So the Bugatti Chiron was able to hit 100 kilometers per hour in just 2.4 seconds. They were able to hit 200 in 6.1 seconds, 300 in 13.1 seconds, and 400 in 32.6 seconds. Then they were able to brake from 400 down to zero in 9.3 seconds. Now, Koenigsegg didn't provide their 100, 200, or 300 kilometer per hour times, but they did provide the 400 to zero and the 0 to 400, and they also have a plot of the acceleration on their YouTube video. So what I did is I literally took that plot from their YouTube video and counted pixels to estimate their 0 to 100, 200, and 300 times. And I know some of you are going to be cautious about me doing that, which is why I did a control. So I used the same methodology I did for 100, 200, and 300, and I did it for 400 to see if it would match up with their claim. And counting pixels, the way I did it, I got 26.85 seconds versus their claim, which was 26.88 seconds. So only off by 3/100. Basically what I'm saying here is you can trust these numbers. Now, Koenigsegg talked about the poor track conditions in the low levels of grip, and you actually see that in their data. So 0 to 100 in 4.15 seconds, which obviously for the Agera is not very good. It could definitely do better with better track conditions. So lots of wheel spin they were having there. 0 to 200 in 8 seconds flat. And that, you know, proves they were having quite a bit of wheel slip in that 0 to 100, because in less time they went from 100 kilometers to 200 kilometers than it took to go from 0 to 100. Shouldn't be the case. They said they were getting wheel slip as high as 180 kilometers per hour. And then 0 to 300, the time here is 13.35. So about dead even once they get to 300 kilometers per hour. Bugatti still has a slight edge. And then they're significantly quicker to get to 426.88 versus Bugatti's 32.6. Now, as far as braking, something interesting happened. So Bugatti actually stopped in less time, 9.3 seconds versus 9.56. However, they did it in a longer distance, 483 meters for the Koenigsegg versus 491 for the Bugatti. And so basically why I think this happened is Bugatti has an air brake that deploys, but it takes 0.8 seconds for that air brake to deploy. So that's a lot of time where it's traveling at a very fast speed and not decelerating at its max decel rate. And so once that's deployed, its deceleration rate, of course, improves. It's able to stop very quickly, but a lot of distance has already been covered. But ultimately, they're pretty equal in braking, you know, off by less than 10 meters from 400 kilometers per hour to zero. So very even in the braking game. Now, something I thought would also be interesting to do was to analyze the G-forces of these accelerations. And so we're going to use this as our example, 0 to 100 kilometers per hour. Acceleration, the average acceleration is equal to the change in velocity divided by the change in time. Our change in velocity is 100 kilometers per hour for this segment. So 27.7 meters per second, that's the same as 100 kilometers per hour. We're dividing that by our change in time, which is 2.4 seconds. That gives us 11.57 meters per second squared. We divide that by gravity, 9.81 meters per second squared, and that gives us our acceleration of 1.18 g's for the Bugatti Chiron from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour. Now we can fill in the rest of these for the delta of 100 kilometers per hour to 200 kilometers per hour. The Bugatti averaged 0.77 g's from 200 to 300, it averaged 0.4 g's, and from 300 to 400, it averaged 0.15 g's. Now for the Agera, there was quite a bit of wheel slip, so that 0 to 100 only accelerating at 0.68 Gs, and then actually improving from 100 to 200 at 0.74 once they got out of that wheel slip and were able to put all of their power down, perhaps a little bit more added downforce from the speeds they're getting to. Then from 200 to 300 averaged 0.53 Gs. And from 300 to 400, they were at 0.21 Gs. So what have we learned? What are our conclusions? Well, basically this entire race was won and lost between 300 and 400 kilometers per hour. That's where all of the time was spent. Bugatti was actually quicker for the whole race, up to 300 kilometers per hour, and then it lost it from that final leg of 300 to 400, and that's where it spent so much time accelerating. The Agera was actually accelerating with 40% more Gs than the Chiron on average from 300 to 400 kilometers per hour. That's where it was able to make up all its ground. It didn't have great traction, so it wasn't that quick from 0 to 300, but it made up all of that ground in the 300 to 400 segment, and that's why it was able to run the race. Now, it's important to think, if you were actually sitting in these cars, which one would you enjoy riding in more? Actually, you'd probably have a lot more fun in that Chiron because it's accelerating with much higher G-forces initially. So that 0 to 125 miles per hour or 200 kilometers per hour, it's gonna have those really hard-hitting all-wheel drive G-forces that's gonna really set you back in that seat. Versus the Agera was just having some wheel slip, trying to get traction so it could really start to put that power down, which it did in those super high speeds. So it was the quicker car, but you know, in those lower speeds, it'd actually be more fun to be riding along in that Chiron. I think that's at least worth pointing out. Then here we have the measurement, which I didn't discuss previously, but basically the G-forces for braking, super even. So, you know, based on distance, not based on the time, and this is, you know, 1.28 Gs versus 1.3 Gs. So really, you know, pretty much even, 0 to 300, 13.1, 13.35. You can see very close there, up to 300 kilometers per hour. You can see very close in the braking. All of this race was won and lost in that 300 to 400 kilometer per hour segment. Also, I think it's worth mentioning that the Koenigsegg could be faster if they had better traction conditions. Obviously, they were having some wheel slip occur from 0 to 100. They had wheel slip as high as 180 kilometers per hour. So if they could improve those low times, they could take some time off of this overall time. So why was the Koenigsegg so much faster from 300 to 400 kilometers per hour? Well, first of all, it does have a major weight advantage. So it's 600 kilograms less than the Chiron. Also, it probably has a pretty significant aerodynamic advantage. So its frontal area is 1.873 meters squared versus, they don't have information for the Chiron, but if the Chiron is anything like the Veyron, 2.07 meters squared, it could be somewhere around that, perhaps a little more, perhaps a little under. But point is, less surface area means it's able to punch through that air better. Of course, the power required to punch through air exponentially increases as you get into higher speeds. And so, you know, that advantage will become very clear once you get to these higher speeds. Also, all-wheel drive versus rear-wheel drive. You know, the Chiron does have more horsepower at the crank than the Agera RS, but it's only sending power to two rear wheels versus this is sending power to all four wheels. So those, you know, power loss could be perhaps more with the Chiron. So, you know, all things considered, it is going to be losing more power through the all-wheel drive system. One thing kind of holding it back a little bit. Makes it super fun from 0 to, you know, 200 kilometers per hour. But after that, the Agera RS has the advantage, just sending power to those two rear wheels. So thank you all for watching. And if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below.